Tell them at home what kind of life we're living.
They might be able to send me over a few £1,000.
As an ethnic minority here in this country, when we got off the boat at Holyhead originally in the 50s and 60s, our life expectancy was reduced by 12 years. I would say it's a lot higher. Those 60% are probably first generation Irish. I would say there's a lot more second generation Irish, but maybe have lost their identity and maybe that's one of the reasons why they're homeless, because they don't know who they are.
I came over in the 60s. I was 17, I think. I seen a first cousin of mine. He came home with his wife and he'd nice clothes and everything, and I was only getting 30 bob a week with a farmer. And I asked his wife one night, I said, would you take me to England? She says, don't say anything. She says, we'll sit and do the fair.
Shaska Sanai.
Skanai Shved.
We must shape long, near a man shape long take ish. We must shape long take Dostay Satisha.
When I came over here, I was 14 years of age. And I was walking with my brother. I couldn't walk with the family.
So I was delighted with all the freedom I had. The first thing I done was I went in and had a pint with him. He said, I'll get you a job now. He said, in the building. He got me a job at John Molam's, an English firm.
I was a host girl, Kirsten. Agat. I'm a machinist like Karin Jess. Agat Fosma. I guess I'll Latino on them, that's a shape on day.
And then I met a gang of Irishmen after a few months in the pub, and they said, who are you working for? I said, I'm working for John Molam. Oh, come with us and you'll get it into the hand. I ended up with John Murphy, cabled in the back of a wagon with a canopy in it, getting £2 sub a day and 30 bob a day, that time the old money. Drinking it every night, shirt open down to here, a pair of hobnail boots, back to the hobnail.
Hoyle Murphy, Macho, Gabir, me, Tivamog, Warren, Tog. Oh, how the wishy, Sir Tirin Shemme, we fit on as Gachtro. We can pay Jowler, Jacob. For tyrant er chen vroig Skan amsach per Wellingtons For Marcel leche moir
The subcontractors came in the scene. They said, we'll give you £4 a day, no tax, no questions asked. The Irishman exploited the Irishman here. The Englishman wouldn't exploit you. If I had the good luck of staying with John Molam, I'd have a good job. I'd be trained to do something.
Be paying taxes and you'd have stamps.
I would. Yeah. Now I have nothing on the income support after all these years.
Hasn't told about her, ni smoke. She did a beginning. Bishamach Lashera. The day I've known where my job is the worst thing. Not a hammer I do egg. Yes, it's 3 year margin. I guess I knew what's all eggy. Yes, she cared in my mouth. Is chin. I seen you get shake walk. I guess it's not been in Kirch naked old walk. In job come on. After an inch stacks, Shanghair Hollis and an inch stacks, the club from home at the Walla. They dig one long good young in the egg. Was Kirchin, Bech Michel Martin, and you make get a idiot like that tree. kegar magayum. Team, gonna wash line here. A leisure job. So see go per reach. What can us know here? What can reach to the reach?
I wasn't married, like she was third generation Irish Leicester. And I keep telling her that, oh, there was a big blowout in the cable and such a place, we had to work late. Well, we weren't working late, we were in the pub.
Drinking.
And of course the bills start coming up and I started getting roughed in. She threatened me with her brothers one night and I said, your brothers? I said, they were only black and tans. I said, I can't tell you, it landed out in the middle of the road.
I went along, I met a girl, she was next to a street girl. Now, I ended up, I had 14 lorries. 14 lorries I had on the side. And I had plenty of money, and I married her. I had 8 kids. You know what? My house, I paid £85,000 cash for it. She at the house now, and I am sleeping in a car up the road with no steering wheel in it.
In the 80s and 90s, had a glue new air in the organal, glue in the lawn.
I was just about 19, when I landed on the shore with my eyes big as headlights. Like the thousands and thousands that came before, I was going to be something. I smiled at the man screwing out of my face as I walked down off of the gangway.
February of 97, couldn't get no work in Ireland and I went to work as a living bar person in Wembley.
Right.
And I was working there for about 2 weeks and the man, an Irish man as well, who owned the bar, told me he was going to pay me £130 a week and 2 meals a day and all that crack. And I was there 2 weeks, he hadn't showed me nothing, not even a cup of tea or nothing.
He gave you nothing?
Yeah. So then one day...
Was he Irish?
Yeah, he was Irish and all. Never worked for your own, huh?
Mm.
And then one day... I took £2 out of the till to pay for my lunch and I put in an IOU and he tried to say that I was stealing out of the till the whole time.
Mm-hmm.
And so I ended up having an argument and they kicked me out on the street, so okay. I was homeless.
I just left school and I wasn't too interested in getting a job and I'm not aware too pleased with that, you know, so...
Okay.
You know, we were having big arguments and you were just getting worse and worse, you know.
Like, you know, it could have been perceived as normal teenage stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Just you decided to go.
Yeah, it just sort of gets worse and worse and get out of my place and you got to stay with your mates for a night and stay with another mate for a night. You know, and then you go home. And then the next time it takes a bit longer, you know what I mean, to get back in.
I think the people that do come over are less able than the people who came in the 80s to cope with situations. A lot come from very fractured backgrounds, may have been very bad education, or may have been let down or missed out by the education system and have a high level of needs, may have be care leavers, come from fractured families. I think that preparedness for immigration needs to be taught and needs to be supported by the Irish government, that they need to recognise that people are still coming, the people that do come now are generally less well equipped to cope with life in a large city.
It's interesting, the demographics. You've got the older ones that might have come from the country, from a rural background.
Yeah.
Small little farms, small little rural communities.
Too many to feed, yeah.
And what you're finding now is a lot of them are coming from urban backgrounds, and that's more the history now, you know. In fact, I was talking to a guy there a couple of weeks ago who's from Dublin. He said he came to Camden Town, which is the drug capital of London, if you like, to escape the drugs in Dublin. The drug scene is so bad in Dublin. Every time he walked out the door, he was being harassed. He was trying to get off heroin, and he came to London to try and escape.
Mm. Come on and show me the car. Oh, is that it?
You make sure you tell them at home what kind of life we're living.
They might be able to send me over a few £1,000.
How do they know if they send you a few bob that you won't drink it? How do they know you'll sort yourself out?
I wouldn't drink it.
What would you do with it?
I'd just get a nice woman like you. Would you stop asking stupid questions?
The back seat is mine. I sleep in the back.
How are you sleep, Tom?
Yeah, put up the window. He won't charge me rent now.
I'm looking for rent and he won't pay me.
Two cans a day.
Two
one
cans.
In the morning and one at night.
If to stay there?
Yeah.
I thought you were friends.
You know the best way to avoid a hangover?
No.
Stay drunk.
Ani shag gir der ga megen um fasa bark. Sham foti vi ham. Hali nin polar man gas kota. Nyar kana ne ye. Ach tim pos petri tsikh ko gar matin kara khol gar matin shmeri ye fafur. Kha hash aydu go shul hart. Hara prehre ken sa kha shis. Khonik man at sibi tiana gas ta gas. Qabliyana gas. Peter mehin khama mamlan on chiram hay ya pagratu shaxtu nu waqtu plant shna khiram hay
katya gus
katya gana gehan las agolu golun dime emi im even gana men chori be olta chapa nerje ka ni saporna na golchi saporna o ta shashin suga nira ma suga nu kossa dime Майкен тасадына чахнисы борна галчисы бо. Гаса чадаш колохиб гатай.
Касан капатор буинцы гасу.
Ва черда тароп. Буэн мишамаха. На каса тагача лаг. На каса тагача лаг. Шина харлогамса. Дима на касу. О,
тис харбилия. Тис харбилия. Террибил альтгеру, you know. Freezing, like in nowhere to put a... Trying to put the blankets to keep them dry and everything, you know. It was terrible. And how did you keep warm at night, Winnie? We try to keep warm, like, you know, keep put loads of blankets over us, but it's no good though. It'd still be cold, like, still be freezing, like, you'd be shivering, you know, shivering all night.
On the streets, I got mugged 3 times in the 1 week.
And show me, what happened, show me your hand, what happened to your hand, show me.
My hand, and that was the other night, that's the only, I've broken, it's all touched them.
Oh, sorry, that was really sore, sorry. Are they broken?
Yeah, they're broken.
And how did that happen?
I got mugged again the other night.
Even if you got 5p in your pocket, they're going to take that 5p. But if you got £100 in your pocket,
Tom, tell the
fucking truth. They take that. They take the £100 and they do a runner. But if you got no money, that's when you get the hiding because they're wasting their time.
But I met some good young lads. I met an English lad in. Wilson Park one day. I was sitting down with a bottle of cider and I had an old blanket. I'll never forget. And he was cycling down with a mountain bike. He was about 17. Next thing, he cycled around 3 times. He came back and said, do you want a fag? I got it. He cycled around again. He came over to me. He said, you know, he built all our motorways. And he took out his wallet and he handed me a £20 note. He says, I know what you're going to do with it. But he says, look, he says, we'll book you in somewhere. He says, I know what to do. He says, for God's sake, he said, my old man worked with the Irish. He said, that's all he said to me. He cycled off again. You meet some good fellas.
But Tom, as you're getting older and if you're living on the streets, you know, pneumonia, chest infections.
That's why we need a hand in our hand all the time.
What?
It blocks out.
The bad things.
Yeah, it blocks out everything. If you wake up in the morning with £2 in your pocket, you say, right, I go down to this half license.
I'm going to get 2 cans.
Yeah, you're going to get 2 cans.
And when you don't have any money for cans, what would you...
When are you going to go and...
I'll meet the likes of him. The likes of him and...
Or whatever, and...
Yeah, but the price of the then can. Once the half license know you, you get the state. The thing is, with the drinking, right? He might get paid Monday, I might get paid Tuesday, John might get paid Wednesday, and he get paid Thursday.
So that's called for
the money.
Oh, you have the money between you, sort of.
Yeah.
All right, so you share?
We all share. We do,
yeah.
We all share. We have to share. That's the way we are. Otherwise, you don't survive.
For the first 3 years I was over here, I was just, drink and Valium and, you know, that sort of thing, you know, and speed and stuff, you know.
And how did you come about getting on the gear? Like, how did heroin happen? It's just
curiosity more than anything else, you know. I was just, like, seeing people and seeing how much hassle they were going through to inject themselves. They'd have no veins and all. I seen all that hassle.
What was the buzz that they were going through so much hassle to do with?
Yeah, if it's that much hassle, it must be really good, you know what I mean? I can get a bag for £10. That would do me.
For how long?
About 12 hours.
And how many hits in that? One hit in that, but
it'll do if I get a bag for 15, it's basically two. It's about the size of two or three times. So usually what I do with a friend is two of us go and buy a bag and we have a hit each other and have 15. Yeah.
If I get it for nothing, I wouldn't take it.
Hello, none of us here.
If you gave me any drugs there, I wouldn't take it.
Just the drink.
Alcohol.
Any kind of drink. Any kind of alcohol.
Is enough.
Yeah.
Anything.
Any kind of drink, but not that champagne is a glory white cider. I'd rather a bottle of cider than a bottle of champagne.
When my blackout was again, I was a good table.
And I had to crawl in here. I was deranged with depression and drink. And I came in one day, we were having a meal down there, and I wouldn't talk to no one. I was sitting on my own, and I had hatred. And I hit the table a wallop because I thought everyone was against me. And one of the staff came down and she said, "Are you on medication?" Like a fool, I took it out. I was on Prozac. And she snapped them out of my hand. She said, "You can't have any more of them. What were you drinking this morning?" I was drinking cider. And then Pauline and John Glynn met me. And John Glynn says, "Look, would you want to think about getting a detox?" Well, I promised him 3 or 4 times. But I thought, well, I have a few bob, I'll be all right. A couple of drinks, I'll just go down the park and get a pint of that. No. But eventually I had to crawl in and tell him, "Look, I'll have a detox, will you get me a detox?" And I did, and Pauline and her friend took me down in the van. And I done 4 weeks in
it. I never went into detox. I tried it didn't work for me.
Okay.
It doesn't work for some people. I did it myself. I stopped drinking on the streets myself.
No, I don't like it.
I still can go to the pub and have a few pints, but I won't drink at home now, I won't drink a can.
Oh.
I did that myself now, because detox doesn't work for me.
Rory wanted to help. Substance misuse. Maybe he wanted to go in for a detox. Maybe get him in for a detox. Rory'd have to want it, but Rory feels he can do it himself. You know,
you have to make that decision. Like the last time, it was every time you don't have any, it's always this is getting bad. I don't want to do this and all that. As soon as you have that hit, it's like, why I do it. You know.
The most important thing in the first place is to make that initial contact, and one of the characteristics of that homeless people experience, I think, is a lack of trust of mainstream services, of the wider community, because I suppose in many ways they feel that they've been dumped and left to fend for themselves. And the abuse that they often get on the streets suggests that they're, you know, not only not wanted, but they're not a part of, you know, mainstream society. So day centres like this and outreach workers like John play a valuable role in, you know, getting that kind of first contact with people.
We may be in contact with men for the last 4 or 5 years who are still drinking, that's fine. But once you build up the trust, then you can encourage them to come in here like and work on the basis of harm reduction. And that is like if a lad can come in here and get access to something to eat, access to a shower, access to a GP or doctor or whatever. But to build, it's the trust is to build up that trust, and when they're ready to address the alcohol. There's a man there I've been working with for five years, right? And he's known me he's come in here, and there just before the Christmas, he actually approached me for help. He said, you know, finally it dawned on him. And at this present moment, he's actually finishing his detox, and now he's considering going on to rehab. And that's success, but it took 5 years.
See this Cricklewood Homeless Concern?
Mm-hmm.
Especially that girl down there.
Pauline.
We'd all be dead without them. See that Pauline over there?
Mm.
I'd marry her tomorrow morning if she'd let me.
Ta chimple shachtu, beijit ochtu, people langen se stechen se. Brannim se hart, gif gwymi me rodi, waisim dana, cachul se na na shayun. And nobody touched you at the end of the shop.
We're in the hostel here.
Oh, what's
yeah.
that like?
Oh, it's lovely, yeah, it's beautiful, yeah.
What do you have? Do you share a room or?
Me and John is in one room together.
With yeah. So you have your own little, it's yeah, like your own little flat.
Our own little flat, yeah. Two single beds, but it's lovely.
My wife and I have been 15 years together, a long time, very long time.
Yeah.
I mean, guess to get married. Yeah. And hopefully
it's impossible for a lot of people to move out of this place because they have a home here and they have a community here, you know, particularly for a lot of the older guys. They wouldn't survive out in their own. There's people who've been here for 20, 30, 40 years, you know.
My mistake was I should have gone back to Ireland when I was 15, but I stayed over here. And as you know, you're young, you're free, as you said, you're free and you can do anything you want.
And now would you go back?
Oh, I'd definitely go back now, yeah.
You'd like to go
but
home?
But I won't go back to my family though. Because right. I'd like to do it on my own.
Right.
It's just an independent thing.
But you'd like to go home and settle.
I would like to go back home and settle back home, yeah.
What are you supposed to do then when you get back there? I can't go to me mother or my brothers and sisters back there.
I can.
No. Why, Tom?
I've been too imbalanced. You see, if you go back there, you've got to be independent.
Okay.
And you've got to have your own wallet in your pocket.
Yeah.
The Kerrymen's Association took me home, which was 2 years ago. I spent 9 months at home and I never got such a beer torturing at home in Listowel. Things must be awful bad now in England as you're back. We have the plastic paddy here tonight.
Oh,
any more plastic paddy is coming. I had an old room over a pub. And
so you weren't welcomed with open arms at all?
I was never afraid that I was going to take their corner. I tried to get a job in Kerry Co-op. I knew a bloke told me you haven't a chance in hell.
So you weren't welcome at all?
I wasn't welcome there.
There's troubles back in Ireland as well, you know what I mean? Like,
a hassle at home and stuff?
Yeah. Not really at home, but just in general, you know what I mean? Like,
so you wouldn't be too comfortable about going home?
You get a lot of hassle off the Gardaí and all that over there for no reason, like, so.
They may not be able to afford to go home for one. They may not want to go home because they haven't come to London and been the success that people expect. It becomes a burden of shame and guilt, and they start to beat themselves up about not doing so well. And
it's pride, the fact that you haven't done so well, you haven't set out, you haven't came back with the targets and the goals and the dreams that you set out with.
We run a project called Ashling, and the idea is to bring people back home just for a holiday and see what it's like, just to break the ice, you know, put the toe in the water, if you like, and maybe establish contact, but initially establishing contact with the homeland before they even think about going back to visit family or anything like that. But to actually persuade people to make that first step, it takes a lot of work, you know, it takes a long, long time. There's guys I've been trying to persuade in the 7 years that I've been here to try and make that step, and they just haven't been able to do it, you know. Johnny's been back with us on the trip a few times, yeah.
Have you been back a few times, Johnny?
Well, like, we're 16 days back in Clare. And Mayo were treated like kings and queens, born in Clare and Mayo. And any part of Ireland that we went to, for the 16 days we're over there.
That's right.
It was 63 years ago since I was in it. And I knew what we visited the country after 53 years.
Yeah.
10 came here from Cricklewood, and we went to Mayo, and the hospitality that was that we received, but also the effect that this had on our guests who came over for a week's holiday in Ireland, the change, you know, in the environment, it was so noticeable. There was lads who had been drinking these super drinks for months, and within a week had actually reduced, and were able to eat, were able to address their hygiene, were taking part in cooking, which I haven't never had an opportunity to do here. And those things seem very simple, or very, you know, to people who are used to that. But for some, it was a chance to, you know, to feel part of the community again.
It would be nice if their own country maybe helped them out. You know, in that way, and maybe put something back.
And we do get support from the Irish government, but as John and Pauline are indicating, we need more resources to make sure that we can take people off the streets. Not just take them off the streets, move them back into
society,
normal society, so that they can kind of maintain a quality of lifestyle that I guess you and I,
that they have every right.
We don't even expect, we just take it for granted.
I'm 4-0 this year, I tell you what, to reckon life begins, but I think mine ends. Because what's happened over my hand that I'm not giving in, I'm just going to die for it.
It's so dangerous to live
it's
on
so
the streets.
Dangerous. So who cares? Who cares?
Eventually, I suppose, they'll die.
On the street.
They'll die on the street. Right. They'll die alone. They might have no identification in their pocket. There's many an Irishman.
Just another Irishman who died.
Just another
pauper's grave. Maybe the Irish community will make a collection to give me kind of a burial.
That's it.
That's what would happen to me only for coming here anyway.